Alrighty, I think we're about ready.
I'd give him a second.
Is that a second yet?
Let's count it down. 3, 2, 1.
I think we're ready. Buckle up. You are listening to Musicians and Beyond with Sarabian and Lawhorn, or Lawhorn and Sarabian, where we bring you the backstage info on the life, the lyrics, and the long journeys of the music industry. Mark, it's been a little while. It's great to be back in the studio with you.
Happy to be back in after the little hiatus we've had. Happy to be back here in Winchester at WinCam Studios.
Yeah, these people here are great. We got Dane, we got Kayla, we got Dave, and we got Maeve.
All of our.
Last episode, we had the 17-year-old, it was actually his birthday, Gavin Marenghi.
Gavin was episode 97. We had a great time with him. His dad was in the studio with us. Fantastic interview, great music. And Gavin's gone on to release his album now. It is out, and I suspect it's doing very well.
It's doing excellent. Excellent. And he's got a lot of shows, and some of them are sold out already. So if you have not heard our episode with Gavin, go back and listen to the Gavin Marenghi episode. Check him out. Download some of his music. You know, his new stuff's fantastic.
It really is.
Yeah. It is. And he was a second time episode.
Much like a gentleman we have with us tonight.
What a segue that was. Wow. Who do we get have
softball's
tonight?
Right there. I'm hitting him right out of the park.
Who do we get today, Mark?
Today we have Chris Gendron.
Chris, welcome once again.
Thanks, guys. How's it going?
You know, it's going great. What a difference a couple of months makes.
Yeah, cranking. It's been a wild couple months for sure.
Yeah, maybe get a little closer to the mic. There you go.
Yeah.
So, yeah, last time you came in, you were hoping for a bunch of things to happen, and believe it or not, a lot of your dreams have come true. Can you tell the listeners and viewers what the heck has been going on in Chris Gendron's life?
Yeah, it's been wild. I've been booking a bunch of gigs, bunch of shows up in the New England area. I was working full time and then also trying to be a full time musician. So, you know, playing 5 nights a week, whether I'm doing solos or with the band, the Rock Island Cowboys. So we're playing all over the place. I put my notice in at work. It was just it was time, and I played my couple gigs that weekend, and I wake up on a Monday morning to a text message from Rob Benton asking me if I want to go out on tour. So
wow,
I was like, absolutely, hell yeah. When do we leave? He said in a week, be at my house on Monday at 6 p.m. and off we go. So
just like that, the timing was unbelievable. Yeah. How did you get hooked up with Rob?
So I actually, you know, I've seen Rob play a bunch out at Hampton Beach. As a kid, that's when. That's when he was out there, and but I don't know Rob, and didn't. I do now.
You're a lot closer to him now than you were a week ago.
Yeah, a lot closer to him now. Yeah, I didn't. So I was playing at Macris Lobster House up in Loudoun, New Hampshire. Big shout out to them, because if it wasn't for Sarah, fabulous bartender up there, if it wasn't for her taking a video of me, Rob wouldn't have seen it, which, you know, jokingly with everyone growing up, you know, my buddies, they're like, oh, you're going to make it. And I'm like, yeah, probably not, man. It's okay. I'm having fun. But, you know, I always joked that if I did get discovered, someone would be using the facilities. That's how I said it. You know, most people's likes come from people sitting. And so, funny story is Rob saw that video that they took of me at Macris, and sent me a message that Monday morning saying, hey man, like I saw your video and want to take you out with me for 2 weeks. So, you know, technically I did get discovered while he was sitting on the thinking throne. So
wow.
Yeah. Wow. So packed my bags, you know, made a bunch of stickers. I think I made 300 stickers in 5 days. Made a bunch of stickers, packed up my stuff, got my guitar serviced, and away I went. I went out for 2 weeks. We left on Monday at 6 p.m. and I flew back from North Carolina on Saturday the 13th, and then came back. Yeah.
Amazing.
Tell us about the journey on the road. Where did the tour take you?
So we started off in Ocean City, Maryland. You know, went all over Jersey, Wildwood, went down into Maryland. We played in Essex. You know, I think we played in Virginia. Also played in North Carolina, Franklinton. So that was my last part of the show. And I flew back from there. So it was absolutely insane, you know, darting back and forth across Jersey, Delaware, Maryland, you know, back and forth. You know, you get to the show at four in the morning, the new venue. You go to sleep for, you know, 5-6 hours. You wake up, you load in, you sweat, loading all the things in, setting it up. There's only four of us on the bus, you know, Rob, me, Ryan Russo, his lighting production director, and then we had the bus driver Chris Tripp, who's awesome, got us safe everywhere we needed to be. But you know, we load in, we get everything set up, and go back to the bus for an hour or two, you know, change, get ready to go, play the show, and then after the show's done around 10:30, we're breaking everything down, loading it back on the bus, and off to the next venue. It's a nonstop. It's got to be a well-oiled machine, and if you're missing something, it shows. You know, there's a chink in the armor. You got to keep pushing. Yeah. So it was probably the wildest experience ever. But you know, everything I thought it was and hoped it would be. And it's twofold. You know, depressing to come home because you're like, oh man, like I finally had it, and you have it for a second in the palm of your hand, and then you got to let it go. But you know, you just got to hope that it's not the end. You know, there's another phase, another door opening. But it's good to be back home. The routine of being back home at the venues, you know, I have my residency at the GOAT in Manchester on Wednesday nights after line dancing. You know, so I have that. That's routine. So it's nice. You know, I'm playing with the band constantly too, so that's always fun. But yeah, no, I definitely want to do it again for sure.
That's awesome.
Hope to, at least.
So first tour is under your belt.
Yep.
You're back now setting up gigs for the next, couple of months.
Yep. I'm still booking. I'm pretty full to, which, you know, I'm super, super blessed and,
that's awesome,
and grateful for. I'm pretty booked for the rest of the summer. There are still dates open, that I could book and would book, you know, but you know, getting to this weekend, Saturday, my band goes in the studio to finally record that song that I had debuted on your podcast last time. So that's getting recorded this weekend. Hopefully get it, you know, mastered and everything, and then out on Spotify and iTunes, hopefully by the end of August, beginning of September. And that's when I'm hoping to head back down, you know, and start, you know, displaying that out there, getting it hit on the playlist, and maybe taking another trip down the East Coast
and a little album release tour.
Yeah,
that wouldn't be bad.
Yeah, it wouldn't be a bad idea. You know, trying to make the dreams come true, and it doesn't stop just, you know, because one thing stopped. You gotta keep pushing, looking for the next outlet, and looking for the next door. And if it's not open, and kick it. So.
That is one thing about you, is you really don't take no for an answer.
I don't like no. That's good. Could also be a downfall of mine, persistence, that sometimes you just need to be like, okay, like, you know, you don't have to win that battle. But no, if there's something I want, if it wasn't worth working for, you know, everyone would be trying to get it. So
absolutely. Yeah. Yeah.
So your life has really changed musically, probably within the last 9 or 10 months. Just really, you were out playing a couple gigs.
Yeah.
You did the Seabrook Idol.
Yep.
You got a lot of connections there,
yep,
and things have just snowballed for you.
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's been absolutely incredible. I think I posted that the first week when I kind of decided to give the solo thing a try. You know, fully invested in it. I've done solo gigs my whole life, but I was really content playing with the band, and still am. I love my band members. But at the same time, you know, I wanted to bring something to the scene that I felt like wasn't really being addressed, that there was a need for. You know, the line dancing's becoming big again. That's my style, that 90s, early 2000s outlaw attitude. You know, we're here to have fun. And you know, my motto has always been, if I can get someone to walk into a bar and leave their BS, their bills, their drama at the door, you can come in for, you know, even if you're there for 45 minutes, for that 45 minutes, I can, you know, get you to let those go, I did my job, you know what I mean? And that's what every entertainer, you know, the Morgan Wallens, you know, Sturgill, Tyler, you know, they're all trying to do the same thing. So if I can get that done, you know, locally around here, then awesome. You know, it's not just about going out and getting hammered and that's that. You know, so there's a lot of people since COVID that are coming back out going, you know, I miss the live music. So, you know, the scene's alive and buzzing. So wanted to throw my name in the ring and it all started with Seabrook Idol. And ever since then, it's just been booking gigs and gigs and opportunities and not saying no, you know. One of the biggest things is fear. You know, you got to get over that fear of going, you know, if I say no, it's easier to just, you know, say it didn't work out or, you know, there's a problem, but how can I adjust my schedule or my goals to better align with this opportunity? It may not be the one that I was looking for next, but it's the one that's presented itself now. So
you're a full-time musician now.
Yeah.
You have to say no to a lot of things.
Yeah.
Like when you have a gig, you don't go out on the field and sing a song when you're drunk. So no. You got to say no to certain things and focus on work.
Yeah.
That's a different perspective when you're out, isn't it?
Yeah, and you know, being on tour too, you know, the everyone thinks it's all, you know, partying and you know, getting lit and having fun and you know, do it responsibly, but it's work. You know, you're out there, you're working. It's not, yeah. You know, and you're only as good as your weakest link on the tour. So if someone's slacking, you're affecting the whole team. So, you know, I was lucky enough to be brought out in a situation where there wasn't any of that, you know, typical tour drama that can happen. I didn't experience any of that. The whole team is, you know, everyone has their job, everyone has their thing, and
everyone's professionals.
Yeah, and everyone was professional. I mean, there's definitely, you know, boys are boys, and we have some fun laughs, but at the end of the day, you know, we all know we're there and able to do what we're doing because we all do it the same way. And, you know, Rob, for one thing, instills that from the very beginning. Like, this is how we do it, and it works.
Let's talk about that for a moment. You don't know the guy. He sees you perform. He says, I want him to come out on tour, reaches out, bang, it happens. You're out there. You're learning a lot more about him. Earlier, when we were talking off air, you mentioned he became a mentor on that two-week tour.
Yeah.
He's someone that you're looking at saying, I got to emulate some of what he's doing now.
Yeah, you know, to see how he operates on the back end compared to, you know, his performance. I mean, most people take a break, but he plays for 2.5 hours straight. Doesn't
That's
stop.
Crazy.
You know, and if you've seen him play, he's not James Taylor in it. You know,
it's
not,
energy.
It's go from the drop. You know, and there's a countdown at the beginning of his show for a reason. Like it's party time and it's let's have a good one. But then at the same time when things happen, how he handled it in you know, the best possible way, you know what I mean? While we were out there, the generator for the tour bus died. You know what I mean? And that means no AC, that means no you know, no real outlets, no, the refrigerator's running off batteries. Yeah. The bus's windows don't open, so you're driving down the road and it's, you know, it was 95 degrees out with 70% humidity or something like that. So, you know, but how he handled it, it wasn't anyone's fault. Was he upset? Yeah, and he was open with us, you know, the rest of the team about it. You know, hey, this sucks. Like, here's what we're going to do and here's the solution. And, you know, does anybody else have any ideas? Because, you know, this is what I'm thinking. You know, and never took it. You know, no one ever saw what was going on. So, you know, just to see that and go, okay, like, yeah, you can be irritated and mad at the situation, but how do you take a step back and go, okay, how do I get this solved? And what can the team do together? And what can we get done? Cause if we're not playing, we're not making money. You know what I mean? And the only way we're making money is if we're playing, but that's the way we get to the next show. So, seeing how that worked was awesome. Seeing how he, you know, did the social media thing, how he was genuine through it. You know, you see a lot of the fake ones. We've talked about that the last time, you know, just being authentically you. And that's him. He's like, hey, I'm here. I'm having fun. If you don't want to have fun.
He does have a lot of fun.
And he does. And that's all it is let's have fun.
He does a lot of interaction with the audience.
Yep.
Calling him out on things.
Yeah.
You know, doing little things that he changes it up a lot.
Yeah.
Are you learning from him about how you want to do your shows, likes and dislikes? Or?
Yeah, absolutely. It was funny when we were going down. I was like, hey, man, I want the good, the bad, the ugly. Like, this isn't, I want you to sugarcoat it. This is me out here learning. Like, I want it real. And he's like, oh, I'll give it to you. I'm like, perfect. And that's what I, you know, you can't go into a situation like that going, I have no idea what to expect. Right. No idea who I'm going to be involved with. You know what I mean? I never met any of the other guys. It wasn't just Rob, and they never met me. You know what I mean? So to be okay walking in a situation like that and being in a bus, you know, like there's nowhere to go. You know what I mean? If someone, so, but everyone was amazing. But you gotta figure out, like, hey, this is what I want to do, and give it. And I said that to him. I was like, I want to know. I want to know where I can improve or what I'm doing good at, and like push that more. And each time, you know, I tried to bring that energy. You know, that's not the same energy as him, because that's his energy, but still having fun doing what I do my way. And each time I was like, hey, you know, what do you think? He's like, just keep doing you. And that was a really cool compliment to hear from him, was like, you know, there's not much change, just keep doing you. And I try to, from the first note, try to captivate, you know, someone. I want to grab someone's attention. I want someone to go, wait, what was that? And if I can hook you like that, then we're going to have some fun. But going into an environment, not being New England and knowing how New England crowds react, you got to earn it here. I don't think a lot of people understand that. Like, you go to, you know, a beach town, they're already there going to have a good time. But here in New England, like, everybody has live music, and most people are going to a place and they either go, oh, cool, live music, or they're like, live music. Like, so in New England, like, it's tough to grab somebody to make them acknowledge you here more than anybody else. So I feel like I was kind of primed for that when I got down in Jersey, or, you know, Delaware and Virginia and North Carolina. Like, they were coming out to see Rob, to see good music, to come into that venue. But up here, like, you gotta earn the respect before they're even gonna even look at you and acknowledge you. So it wasn't bad.
Yeah. So you went out on tour with someone that's fairly well known.
Yeah.
And you, respectfully, were kind of the unknown.
Yeah.
How did the fans react to you?
They were awesome. They were super, super, you know, nice, you know, nothing but great things to say. And it was very humbling to be in that position too, because I wasn't expecting, you know, being the opener, you're really just there to get everything ready. And then, you know, as the people are coming in for the main act, you know, they have someone to listen to. So my goal was just to have as much fun as I could. Because if I'm having fun, then they'll have fun, and then they'll be ready for Rob. And that was my only thing. So I think one of the ways that I took the pressure off myself of being good was I didn't care how I did, as long as I did my job
right
for Rob.
Fill your role.
Yeah, fill my role. Like, I'm there to get them to like me, but I'm more there to get them ready. So I think a lot of people go into it going, oh, I have to make them like me. I have to do this. I have to grab them. I only have this amount of time. I didn't look at it that way. It was more of a, I have a job to do, and if I can do my job, then maybe they'll go, oh, you know, he was really good. Let's see him again. So.
Right, right. I don't know Rob personally, but from the videos and the music and everything, it seems like you two are a fantastic match.
Yeah, I mean, we definitely have a lot of the same beliefs. You know, we see things similarly. You know, and I also we also like all the same music too. So that, you know, like, you know, old 90s, 80s R&B, you know, jams, like, it doesn't matter, you know. And everyone on the bus was the same way. Like, it didn't matter what was on, whether it was Motown or you know, metal. Like, we all were like, oh yeah, I know that. And, you know, being in that environment where it felt like someone you already knew for so long was cool. It was definitely made it a lot easier. And they're super welcoming. When you get on the bus, Rob literally says, like, hey man, this is your house too. This is everyone's house. It's not just my bus. It's not just my place and you're here. Like, this is everyone's home. Like, you have to be comfortable here. Like, you live here, or it's not going to work. And everyone has to feel that way. So, that was really cool.
So you're listening to Musicians and Beyond with our guest, Chris Gendron, chrisgendronmusic.com. And we're about 20 minutes into the episode, and we haven't heard a song. If you remember, last time Chris was on, he teased us. We didn't actually hear the whole song, his new song. He teased us with it. I'd love to see what he's done with it.
Yeah, and he's going to be recording it this weekend.
Yeah, so this might be a good time for him to warm up, get ready for the Saturday session at the studio.
Yeah, you guys want to hear it?
We want to hear it.
Let's hear Chris Gendron.
So this is called Your Honor. We went in the studio this weekend, so...
'83 and a .45 flashed before my eyes. Those blue lights lit me up. Part one on the way. Another big mistake. I clicked into those cuffs. She didn't even have to say a thing. Flung a diamond ring and took off in my truck. One more time I swore. Oh, but she don't believe me anymore. Can't ask why she said goodbye. I know damn well what I did. Made a promise, then I lost it. Took my problems with another fear. Don't be easy on me because I have a problem. But she's gone, you're on her. Straight ahead, then to the left. Creaky bunk beds, cold showers, dinners in a cup. Yard fight and a black eye. You should have seen the guy, but damn right I got backed up. One more time I swore. Oh, pick myself up off that road. I can't ask why, say goodbye. I know damn well what I did. Made a promise, then I lost it. Took my problems with another feel. Don't be easy on me because I have a problem. She's gone, you're on her. If I knew the hurt I caused, I would have quit. But I grabbed that bottle and took another sip. Can't ask why she said goodbye. I know damn well what I did. Made a promise and then I lost it. Took my problems with another fist. Don't be easy on me because I have a problem. No, don't be easy on me because I have a problem. She's gone, you're on her. She's gone, you're on her.
ChrisGendronMusic.com. You can download all kinds of music, and he's going to be on every single platform available. And that song's going to be recorded this weekend. And when's that going to be available for?
So I'm hoping at the end of August, beginning of September, I'm going to do a release party. Trying to finalize the venue now, but yeah, we're gonna throw a big party. This has been something I've been wanting to do, you know, my whole life. This is another one of those check boxes, you know. I never thought going on tour would happen before a song came out, but I was lucky enough to have it, you know, ready to go, and the whole band's ready to get it down. So, you know, this is the stripped down raw version of it. You know, I'm really excited for everyone to hear the vision that I've had for this for a while and how the whole band plays it. So it'll be really, really, really interesting to see what everyone thinks. I've gotten some good feedback so far, so hopefully they like the final version.
Who else is in your band?
So we got Dave Sebastian playing drums. We got Tommy Colantoni, and then we have Dave Hoffman playing guitar as well. So that's the Rock Island Cowboys. I do the rap. That's all. I only rap for the band. So now I'm the cowboy in it. I play bass as well for the reggae and all the other rock stuff when I'm not singing. For some reason, I can't play bass and sing at the same time. I don't know why. My brain just doesn't compute. It's weird. I can sing harmony all day long, but I can't actually sing lead and play bass. So whenever I'm singing lead, I have to play guitar. So they laugh at me for that one. They're like, "You make no sense." I'm like, "I never said I did." But people are like, "What's wrong with you?" I'm like, "I don't know where you want me to start."
Kind of what we like about you.
where are we gonna start? I'm excited. The band's excited. And I'm hoping also, when I go and do some of these little mini runs, down the East Coast, hoping I can take some of them with me. It's the next step. We'll see what happens. Who knows what's gonna pop on my phone next? I never thought that text would come through. So now it's like, okay, man, what else are you gonna throw at me? Because I keep getting blown away.
Yeah, the doors keep opening left and right for you.
Yeah, it's been insane. I mean, you guys were the first ones to really believe in me in the industry too. So I can't say nothing but thank you. We all get, as artists, fizzled out, or we're always our biggest critic. I'm gonna be honest, going out, I had a lot of doubt in myself, before going out with Rob. I even said that. I told Rob straight up. I was like, "Hey man, a couple of days before, I started to be like, the shiny wore off, and it's like, oh well, hey, you're really going out there." And everyone has that self-doubt and that self, we beat ourselves up about stuff. But it's one of those where I was going out there, I'm like, I don't know if I'm good enough to be doing this. And I had a bunch of people be like, "Listen, he wouldn't pick someone to suck in front of him. You're representing him. He's not bringing you out there so you can look like a fool, and then he comes out looking like the rock star. He wants you to make him look good." And I was like, okay, so there's as new doors are opening and things are being unlocked, so are you as a person growing, which is weird.
Yeah. Definitely so odd. When you went out on tour with Rob, did you feel different before you went out on the stage than you did if you were playing a local tavern? Did you get more butterflies or nervous? Because now your dream is really coming true.
Yes and no. So I don't get nervous. I get anxious. I'm much better if there's things going on before it. So my first show was 3 days after being on the bus. So we left Monday night, had a drive day Tuesday, first show was Wednesday night. So I had some time to get accustomed to the bus life. And then because of where the location was in Ocean City, there was a lot going on where I didn't have a real chance to really think about it. We were already setting up and I'm throwing the in-ears in. So, I'm getting ready. I'm hearing what's going on inside, And all of a sudden, you kind of just open your eyes and you're like, okay. When this starts, my first time on this one, it was the same thing. I wasn't nervous. I was anxious. Time slows down. They always say, going to your destination always takes longer. It feels like it takes longer than driving home from it, because it's the unexpected of what's going to happen. I feel like that's how it is almost everywhere I play. My full band's playing tomorrow night. You can ask every single one of them 20 minutes before we go on. I'm starting to get really fidgety and I need to go outside or do this or do that or check something, because I'm not nervous. I'm anxious. Once I get this in my hands and I'm sitting here, I'm fine.
Yeah, it's like you're pacifying.
When you guys said it when I played, when we did, Seabrook Idol, I did one song without my guitar, and every judge was like, "We could tell you were uncomfortable. Yeah. That's not you." And I'm like, "No, it's not me at all." Sometimes you have to make yourself uncomfortable to grow. We're not trying that anymore. Figured out that does not help me. it's the growth is huge to be able to do that. So
where do you see yourself in a year from now? Because things are really happening.
I like it here.
Yeah. It's comfortable. We got beautiful lights.
We get to hang out.
You're on a great roll.
I mean, I would love to just keep riding it and seeing where it goes, you know, to jump on with, you know, another tour with Rob. Hell yeah. Someone else comes knocking and wants me to go out longer. Hell yeah. You know, I really would like to get some more stuff with the band, so people can really see, my vision, my sound. 'Cause what I do with this and just me and the guitar is awesome. I love it, but there's an attitude and there's a vibe when you come and see me with the full band, and it's, you know, the amp goes to 10, but let's see if there's an 11 there somewhere.
Yeah.
And that's just what it is from start to finish. So if I can start showing that to people, I think might get a little bit more traction. Well,
we need to show some of the venues out there that are watching, and yep, some of the ones that we're going to be reaching out and making sure that they see this. Chris does, you heard his original.
Yep.
He's got a number of those, but he also does covers.
Yeah.
He can entertain everyone in your venue.
Yeah.
And he can put on one hell of a show. So what would you play if you wanted to impress someone right now that's out there watching and you want to say, I want to come on your stage and perform for you and your audience? What would you play?
Are you sitting at home all alone trying to fall asleep? Are you staring a hole through your phone, praying let it ring? Are you watching a movie that you've seen a thousand times? Maybe playing some beer, getting lost in your favorite line. Well, if you're anything like me, you just might be doing whatever it takes out on the nose. But I just wanna hear your voice while I'm on number 8 calling you. Said I was through, I'm dying inside, got my head in a mess. Girl, I confess, lied when I said I'm leaving, not coming back. I'll be the whiskey or the midnight rain. Everywhere I look, I see your face. In my brain, dialed up everything I wanted to say. But I'm still on number 8. Are you stuck at a red light with a marble light on your lips? Does the smoke in your mirror get clear without my kiss? Are you changing the station, replacing our favorite song? Maybe it's a mistake, hit the brakes, I'm moving on. Well, if you're anything like me, you just might be doing whatever it takes out on the stove. But I'm almost out that door. Well, I'm on number 8 calling you. Said I was through, I'm dying inside, got my head in a mess. Girl, I confess, lied when I said I'm leaving, not coming back. I'll be the whiskey or the midnight rain. Everywhere I look, I see your face. And my brain dialed up everything I wanted to say. But I'm still on number 8. Will you pick up when I call? Just forget we loved it all. I don't want to talk, I just wanna hear your voice. Well, I'm on number 8 calling you. Said I was through, I'm dying inside, got my head in a mess. Girl, I confess, lied when I said I'm leaving, not coming back. Might be the whiskey, midnight rain. Everywhere I look, I see your face. In my brain, dialed up everything I wanted to say. But I'm still on a number 8. Away. Away. Yet I'm still on a number 8.
Well, we are live right now on Instagram, and one of the first guys to pop up, Jimmy McWilliams, and he's still on there.
What's up, Jimmy?
Jimmy, we were just talking about you and how you guys all support each other and how much you all appreciate each other and, you know, make things happen. So thank you for being you. Jimmy's got a good career going as well.
And Jimmy's crushing it, which we all knew. We all knew that.
Ray Charles could see that one.
You can't. A blind man said he was beautiful. All right. Like, so you got hair and an attitude like that. You know he's gonna do big things. So.
Son of a bitch.
And then he opens his mouth and it's like an angel. So yeah.
Well, thanks for sharing that song with us. Tell us what else is going on in your life.
Oh, just playing. Just ordered a new guitar. So that's stressful because those are hard to come by. So finding a lefty is almost impossible in general, let alone something that's going to put up to the workload that I put it through. So we got a nice Gibson J45 coming in. So that's the most I've ever spent on my career. We just made another big purchase. So you know,
awesome.
Reaching for the stars, but you know, just playing as much as I can. Yeah. You know, if anybody you know wants me to make the drive down somewhere, I'm in. You know, I want to just show everybody what vibe I'm bringing to the table, and that there's still real country out there, real attitude. It's not all, you know, synthetic beats and how many you know hashtag references I can throw into a song. You know, real country sells, and there's nothing wrong with that stuff. Listen, I'll dance and throw a shot back to it too, and you know, they're awesome songs, but. At the same time, you know, nothing gets you feeling like you do when Kenny Chesney comes on and you're on 101 heading to the beach. You know, your Sweet Summertime comes on. I don't get that same feeling here, and you know, I just don't. So you know, there's music for everything, for everybody's mood and everybody's occasion. You know, I just want to throw my name out there and throw my vibe there for.
Thank God we're in the mood for yours today.
Yeah.
I'll tell you
that. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So before we close the show out, I think we'd like to hear one more song.
Yeah.
And you can play whatever you would like to get out there to the world.
If you want to sponsor him, reach out to Chris. Yeah. ChrisGendronMusic.com.
Yeah. ChrisGendronMusic.com. Thanks to the big man over there. You know, one of my favorites died this year from cancer. So. Mr. Toby Keith, not this year, but you know, we'll do a little Toby Keith.
I bet you never heard old Marshall Dillon say, Miss Kitty, have you ever thought of running away? Settling down, would you marry me? If I asked her twice and begged you pretty please, she'd have said yes in a New York minute, never tithing now. I was an idiot, just stole a kiss as he rode away. He never hung his head up at Kitty's place. I should have been a cowboy. I should have learned to rope and ride. Yeah, wearing my six shooter, riding my pony on and ride. Stealing a young girl's heart. Just like Gene and Rose. St. Louis campfire song. Oh, I should have been a cowboy. I might have had a sake with a funny name. Running wild through the hills, chasing Jesse James. And ended up on the brink of danger. Riding shotgun with the Texas Rangers. Go west, young man. Haven't you been told? California full of whiskey. Women and gold, sleeping out on night beneath the stars. I dream in mine and a prayer in my heart. I should have been a cowboy. I should have learned to rope and ride. Yeah, wearing my six shooter, riding my on your head will dive. Stealing the young girl's heart, just like Gendron, singing those campfire songs. Oh, should have been a cowboy. Yeah, should have been a cowboy. Yeah, should have been a cowboy.
Chris Gendron. Wow, what a way to end the show, Mark. I mean, this guy is a true friend.
He is a real friend. He's a genuine person. He's a great musician. We're having a lot of fun watching this grow, and we can't thank you enough for coming and being our friend.
Thank you, guys.